most of us did not know they existed. We heard about the atrocities, but they gave us no preparation for what we were to encounter.
Guy comes running in and tells everybody, say, they having a maneuver, looks so real, you know. It sounds like they're using live ammunition.
So we were playing cribbage, and we had the radio on, and they said Pearl Harbor was attacked.
And I says, oh, what are you talking about? We're not gonna be fighting Japan. I think the news on the radio is just false because, you know, 10 years earlier, one of the news commentators said that we were going to be invaded by the Martian or something.
And we kept listening to it. And I said, by golly, I think there is something to this. So we ran outside to look around, and sure enough, that before the loudspeakers said that Japan bombed Pearl Harbor. So, oh my God, it's true. Now what happened?
Nobody used the word Jap before. Then all of a sudden, the paper says Jap attack. All of a sudden, our friends were not our friends to a certain degree, meaning that we're not Americans, we're Japs, and we're enemies now.
When the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, our west coast became a potential combat zone. Living in that zone were more than 100,000 persons of Japanese ancestry. Two-thirds of them American citizens, one-third aliens.
It was somewhat shocking to see barbed wire, guard tower, MPs, very, very symmetrical blocks.
They got a blanket hanging from one room to another, or how they were segregated, I guess. And I said, geez, this is worse than the army barracks, you know. But they got kids, mother, wives, you know, all mixed up.
For the most part, they had accepted this as their fate for, I guess, shikata ga nai is the underlying rationalization that they made.
All of a sudden, we're enemies. And yet, the year before, we're neighbors. That's what we couldn't understand. Why? When they asked for volunteers, we wanted to prove ourselves we're just as American as they are.
We had to use our eyes to see our target, find it on the map, or at least know the relative position of the target and our guns. In order to have an appropriate target, you'd have to be informed. You have to be told that there's a machine gun there, there's a tank there, there's an observation post here.
You take the best shot that you can, you know, the best guess, and then they fire one round. What they do at the battery, they will tell you how long it takes for that shell to land. And so that they'll say splash, and then by that time, you should be looking or listening for your shell.
The artillery shells, when they hit the tall trees, will burst. And the fragments, they come raining down like bumblebees. And one shell can kill or injure many, many. I think the group as a whole were really anxious to get into the war effort. If you have that deep ingrained fear of being hurt, it's not the proper place for you.
From what I gather, they were very afraid to be fighting against us. That's the kind of reputation the 442 and the 100 had within the German army.
When some of your close friends get killed, you really start thinking, this must be for real. get in your mind that my mission is to fight for the U.S., do the best I can, and to kill as many Germans as possible. And it seems somewhat inhuman. This happens.
After we crossed the Rhine River, it was just a matter of chasing the Germans all the way down toward the Austrian border. So, and then in the process of chasing them, we came across Dachau.
They told us to get whatever few things we had. We had a blanket and all the small possessions, and line up by the gate and just march us out.
And lo and behold, we already had forgotten that there is a world around us with streets, with houses, with people living in there, living a fairly normal life.
And the gods have turned against us too. It was raining and snowing and sleet. You had those picturesque highways of Bavaria lined with all these dead Lithuanian Jewry and some Hungarians too. Well, imagine what a tragic end. They survived 4 years, and then at the end they were dying on these roads.
Then I could see three piles of something that's about 10, 12 feet high, like a pyramid. And that's when I saw these political prisoners that I heard about. They're all dead, and they didn't have a chance to cremate them because they knew that we were coming, so they evacuated the whole camp, more or less, and they marched them, the one that was able to.
As we were advancing, we accidentally ran across the Jews that were being marched.
The Nazi came and lined us up against the wall, and he put light on me, and I said to the woman next to me, kicking her with my foot, "This is so stupid, just shoot us and get it over with. We know it's coming."
First of May it was. They brought us into a wood clearing, and I was dead already. I fell down, and I was covered with snow. Our luck was that the Japanese 522nd Artillery Battalion was very near. We could hear them. They were shooting at the Germans. They were going to take chances with Americans finding them, so they took off.
My first encounter was these lumps in the snow, and then I didn't know what they were, and so I went and investigated them and discovered that they were people.
In the morning I woke up, I opened my eyes, and everybody is bending over me. There were four faces. They were unshaved. I thought it was hallucinating, you know. It's how odd I've got to send these oriental-looking angels to ferry me, you know. What to make of this?
Many were dead. They were really emaciated, with wearing the purple and dark striped suits.
Suddenly, somebody was pulling on my blind, and I saw a Japanese man. I started telling him that, oh, yeah, now you Japanese people are gonna finish us off, right? So the man bowed his head to me and said, "We are your liberators."
There was no room for ecstasy. We were completely exhausted. We were deadly worried what happened to the rest of our family. And we were sick, all of us, physically and mentally.
It was the first face I saw. It was the first face I saw this side of hell, so to say. And it was such an impressive face because it was a totally unexpected to see these Japanese appearing before me.
It's such a big thing and such a big shock that you don't immediately react to it.
But I suppose when you look back in history. It's certainly not a unique behavior of a nation or individuals or groups.
There's so many emotions that are running around your head, you know, like get angry. And but you don't know exactly who to be angry at.
It's a type of inhuman behavior that in many respects characterizes man repeatedly.